The Little Ice Age impact on Europe was sudden and ferocious. Using its weapons of plague, famine, and controversially earthquake, the so-called Little Ice Age reduced the population of Europe by around 30 to 50%. The virulence and death toll of the 1348 AD plague is totally unmatched by modern examples. Further, the world mega-famine of 1315 AD, due to both weather and pestilence, was catastrophic. The relentless temperature drops combined with erratic weather are nearly impossible to explain, but mankind had no hand in its inception. What forces of nature caused this catastrophic scenario? Greenland is a classic example of death and abandonment. Let's travel back in time and see what happened. Although the Little Ice Age is a scientific reconstruction, it covers a period when there was a significant and chaotic downturn in climate compared to the prison era. It is classified into four periods from around 1280 AD to 1850 AD. These erratic cold periods are referred to as the Wolf, Spora, Maunder and Dalton weather minima. Those dramatic climate deteriorations were not only cooler, wetter and windier on average, but also vastly more chaotic in their fluctuations, creating the prime ingredients for famine and, curiously, plague. The Little Ice Age followed a period known as the Medieval Maximum that is dated between 900 AD and 1280 AD, which copious records reveal was much warmer than modern times. For instance, grapevines grew in the area of today's Shivering Wales. This was generally a period of prosperity for civilizations. There was a large increase in world population and an era of colonial expansion. During the years 800 AD to 1200 AD, Greenland and Iceland were settled by the Vikings. The medieval warm period allowed this great migration to flourish. Drift ice at later dates posed the greatest hazard to sailors, but reports of drift ice in old records do not appear until the 13th century. Greenland was settled when Erik the Red was banished from Iceland for manslaughter after a series of violent conflicts with his neighbours. He converted his misfortune into the foundation of a new colony. The initial settlement was on a deep fjord on the southwestern coast next to today's Arctic Canada. Conditions were similar to Iceland, which was itself enjoying a warm, temperate climate at that time. Chroniclers even mentioned swimming in Greenland's fjords. Today, totally impossible. The bones of cattle, sheep, pigs and goats collected from archaeological sites reveal the existence of large farms with large productive pastures in what is now often snow-covered wasteland. Erik drew thousands to these three new areas. The Greenland Vikings lived mostly on produce and meat, primarily from cows. Before 1300 AD, trade with European countries was brisk, with many ships plying to and fro trading timber, iron, salt and corn in exchange for furs, skins, butter, cheese and wool. Expansion was in fact prolific enough for the Pope to send a bishop to Greenland. Today, only rare earth exports to China are viable trade goods. During the medieval warm period, crops flourished and the human race multiplied. Germany, for instance, recorded vineyard growth at 700 feet higher elevation than at present. Temperatures worldwide averages 2 degrees Celsius warmer than now. China was 3 degrees Celsius warmer. Our world was a different place. Now see Ian Plimer's research for evidence from tree ring growth, ice cores, sediment cores, glacier retrenchment, sea ice reports, plus a wealth of anecdotal evidence. The Little Ice Age dramatically changed this picture, with the growth of glaciers down mountains in both Europe and China. Increased sea ice, severe and prolific storms, high rainfall, and colder, erratic climates became relentless. Thick sea ice, 3 miles wide, sometimes bordered the English Channel. It was a period when major plagues and famines ravaged the world.
During that time, the Thames was frozen. During that time, the Dutch masters painted these landscapes with hoarfrosts. During that time, people died like flies.
Chaotic weather, I will argue, is most likely due to cosmic influence. By that I mean electromagnetic forces. These constantly changing cosmic influences caused Western Europe to experience a general cooling of the climate between the years 1150 AD and 1460 AD, and an even colder climate between 1560 AD and 1850 AD. That's only 2 centuries ago, creating dire consequences for the people living at the time. Not only was it cooler, wetter, and windier, but notably, the seasons became erratic. The colder weather impacted agriculture, health, and economics, creating social strife and emigration. Increased glaciations, multiple severe storms, and major floods and winds devastated society. Old sea logs and city records reveal all. But what happened to the Vikings in Greenland? By the year 1300 AD, more than 3,000 colonies lived on 300 farms scattered along the west coast of Greenland. Around 1200 AD, drift ice forced ships further south to reach the settlements on the southwest coast alongside Canada. In the 1300s, Barnson wrote, quote, "From Snæfellsnes in Iceland to Greenland, the shortest way, 2 days and 3 nights, sailing due west. In the sea, there are reefs called Gunbirnisia." That was the old route, but now the ice has come from the north, so close to the reefs that none can sail by the old route without risking his life. End quote. So by 1500 AD, the Pope complained that no bishop had been able to visit Greenland for 80 years on account of the ice. His Greenland congregation was already dead. The graves and ruins show that the cold and lack of nourishment turned the average Greenlander from their 5'7" to a severely crippled, twisted and diseased 5 foot by 1400 AD. The Iceland Vikings fared little better. Their population shrank from 80,000 in 1100 AD to only 38,000 by 1850 AD, at the end of the Little Ice Age. By the time Columbus set sail to the Americas, Greenland was dead, and Iceland was struggling to survive. The Little Ice Age minima was a harsh reality. But what were the causes? Certainly not higher carbon dioxide levels from mankind's puny efforts. Our own sun is a major determining factor when it comes to weather. Henrik Svensmark, a physicist and researcher at DTU Space, believes in fact that cosmic rays, which are positive ions, are the major driver of weather. Quote, "In 2005, we actually found unequivocal evidence that the sun and the galaxy is determining climate here on Earth. But for some reason, no scientific journal wanted to publish this. What we could see was that when the magnetic activity on the sun was larger, then the temperature on the Earth was higher." End quote. How does it do this? Henrik Swensmark explains it this way. Our galaxy is filled with high-energy cosmic rays, mainly produced from distant stars. This part of near space, the Sun's heliosphere, acts as a shield against these high-energy rays. If you have a change in solar activity from coronal mass ejections, sunspot activity, solar flares, this moderates the cosmic rays. Typically, from a CME, it drops about 10%. Let's examine the parts sunspot minima and maxima play in the climate stage as we try to understand the effect these cycles have on famine and plague. Sunspot activity and therefore solar flux are an ingredient in controlling our climate. Flux is the emission of various positive ions and electrons emitted by the Sun that mediate cosmic rays and thus, as Henrik Swensmark maintains, weather and precipitation. Cosmic rays interact with the Earth's magnetosphere, at times influencing drier, wetter, windier, hotter, or colder variations in climate. It appears that the 11-year solar cycle is linked to the severity of hurricanes and droughts. This is the thinking of the U.S. National Center for Atmospheric Research, NCAR, which has conducted research that links the solar cycle to global climate. Robert G. V. Baker at the University of New England, Australia, works on a fractal solar emission model and its impact on Earth's climate past, present and future. Baker thinks the solar cycle is a vehicle to predict times of drought. His tracking of sunspots since records were kept in 1876 AD shows that switches in the Sun's poles and magnetic field every 11 years consistently affect Australia's weather. Compilations of sunspot records, which have been kept for four centuries, fit in well with times of drought. At times of prosperity, the sunspot activity is high. Grain prices are low. At low sunspot activity, there are crop failures and high grain prices. Drought varies over a full 22-year cycle with an 11-year maxima to minima turnaround time. There must be a further factor that drives the whole sunspot cycle up and down to cause a little ice age. It demands a cosmic cause. Historian Jean de Venette wrote a curious piece that may provide a clue to this unsolved climate mystery. Quote, in the month of August 1348, after Vespers, when the sun was beginning to set, a big and very bright star appeared above Paris towards the west. It did not seem, as stars usually do, to be very high above our hemisphere, but rather very near. As the sun set and night came on, this star did not seem to me or to many other friars who were watching it to move from the one place. At length, when night had come, this big star, to the amazement of all of us who were watching, broke into many different rays. And as it shed these rays over Paris towards the east, totally disappeared and was completely annihilated. Whether it was a comet or not, whether it was composed of airy exhalations and was finally resolved into vapour, I leave it to the decision of astronomers. It is, however, possible that it was a presage of the amazing pestilence to come, which in fact followed very shortly in Paris and throughout France and elsewhere. End quote. Comets throughout history have been portrayed as predictors of doom. Bright comets are often historically in conjunction with plague, famine, and earthquakes. Is this mere coincidence? The dramatic electrical discharge of comet Shoemaker-Levy 9, as it split into 21 fragments and assaulted Jupiter, is a landmark in modern cosmology. the impact of some comets into the Sun causing incredibly large coronal mass ejections, CMEs, is equally hard to explain. Could comets have electromagnetic effects on weather, life, and the geology of the Earth? It is still a mystery, but one we are perhaps getting closer to understanding our electric universe.